Overseas today, the last of the American embassy personnel in Afghanistan flew out of the capital, Kabul, today and went to India. Most other Western embassies are either closed or closing. The conventional wisdom is that when the Soviets have finally completely withdrawn from the country sometime in the next couple of weeks, the Afghans will set on one another and the capital will be even more dangerous than it is now. While the diplomats were leaving, ABC's Jim Lorry was flying in to take a look.
Flying into the mountain-ringed Afghan capital is enough to take your breath away. The Soviet transport circles quickly downward, firing magnesium flares to divert any heat-seeking missiles. The American-armed anti-Soviet Mujahideen guerrillas are believed in the mountains around the city. Soviet helicopters also escort every landing. Flying out can also be tricky. A plane carrying to India the last U.S. diplomats in Kabul encountered a near miss with a Soviet plane. The evacuation occurs with fears rising that Kabul is about to become very dangerous. The Soviets, meanwhile, say their troops, which still can be seen on the streets of Kabul, will be out ahead of schedule. Afghan troops are stationed at most major intersections. They seem nervous and not eager to welcome cameras, as these troops guarding a gasoline station showed us. Gasoline and bread are in short supply, as most major roads into the city are often cut by rebel forces. The Soviets brought in 3,000 tons of flour this month. The food situation will only get worse when the Russians are gone.
What is not clear is just how long after the Russians leave this city and this government will have. Pessimists say the rebels will launch quick and bloody attacks, and the government will fall within 2 months. Whatever, the Afghans are in for some troubling days ahead. Jim Lorry, ABC News, Kabul, Afghanistan.
From ABC News, World News Sunday, here's Sam Donaldson.
Good evening. The Soviet Union has pulled its last troops out of the Afghanistan capital of Kabul, 9 days before the mid-February deadline for withdrawing all Soviet forces from the country. This surprise announcement from Radio Moscow means that Afghan President Najibullah and his men are now alone in what Western observers believe is a losing fight to prevent the Mujahideen guerrillas backed by Washington from taking power. Jim Lorry accompanied Soviet troops on one of the last convoys out of Kabul.
They were heading home, pushing through the pre-dawn hours to daylight, heading north along Afghanistan's Salang Highway. Afghans waved goodbye. Helicopter gunships provided air cover. Foreign reporters were allowed to escort them only on the last 45 miles of what for most was a nearly 300-mile journey from Kabul to the Soviet border. Aboard our armored personnel carrier, Captain Valery Malenkov. He'd seen 4 years action here, said he's happy to be going home, but would come back if called.
The convoys heading home have now passed through the mountains of the Hindu Kush, where the Mujahideen, the anti-Soviet rebels, are held up, the rebels the Soviets have failed to defeat. Now we're out into open land, only 30 miles now to the Soviet border.
Those anti-Soviet rebels left this convoy alone during its mountain passage. Bad weather, snow, and bitter cold were the biggest dangers. The only mishap in the open stretch, though, was when an APC overheated and caught fire. The defense of this nation is now left to the Soviet-trained and equipped Afghan army. The Kabul government today ordered martial law in the city, President Najibullah vowing to go it alone in a major political rally.
There was a report today in the Soviet newspaper Pravda, which surely must have been good news to many Soviet readers. The last Soviet soldier, the newspaper said, has left the Afghan capital of Kabul. While that may be somewhat premature, there are several hundred Soviets still on duty there. It is a fact that the last major convoy of Soviet troops from Kabul has crossed the border from Afghanistan into the Soviet Union on its way home. Here's ABC's Jim Lorry.
They were putting the best face on it. Soviet troops were coming home. They crossed the Amu River over the Friendship Bridge into Soviet Uzbekistan, tanks and armored personnel carriers in parade formation. With this ceremony, the Soviets announced that all but 20,000 troops were out of Afghanistan, nearly all of those in 5 border provinces. The Soviets were treating this homecoming as a celebration, but celebrating what? Hard to see. A nine-year investment, 13,000 Soviet soldiers killed, and the anti-communist guerrillas stronger today than when it all started. Still, it was a celebration, with even Stevie Wonder music on loudspeakers. Then the standard speeches, and children recited poetry in tribute to Soviet courage. But 20-year-old Pel Gunev knew better than to believe all he heard. 20 months in Afghanistan told him the Afghan war was a mistake. He said a Brezhnev mistake. Still, it was a good welcome home. Local girls on hand with flowers, and they planted kisses, too. And the town of Termiz was ready to send telegrams home for any soldier who wrote one. There'll be another celebration just like this one, February 15th. That's the day that Moscow's Afghan adventure will officially come to an end. Jim Laurie, ABC News on the Soviet-Afghan border.
As the last Soviet motorized unit rolled out of Afghanistan today, Afghan President Najibullah accused neighboring Pakistan of plotting to invade his country and take it over. The Soviet Union has until Wednesday to withdraw what's left of its forces from Afghanistan. Jim Laurie reports that while the nine-year Soviet involvement there may be ending, its impact on Soviet society will be felt for many years.
A Soviet mother in Uzbekistan tearfully reading the last letter from her son. With only 3 months to serve in Afghanistan, he was killed. What can I say, she says, this war tears a mother apart. The pain is portrayed in a new Soviet television documentary, and the picture the Soviet people are getting of Afghanistan through programs like this is not a pleasant one. Vivid portrayals of the war. An execution. Soviet soldiers being killed or wounded. Officials now say 15,000 were killed and more than 35,000 wounded in the nine-year war. This young man trying to adjust to a life without legs. This veteran, haunted by the faces of his fellow soldiers, asks why they died and he lived. As the last troops are coming home, the trauma of Afghanistan is just now sinking in here. The similarities to the American experience in Vietnam are striking. Big power bogged down in a small Asian nation in an unwinnable war. The nation's sons and their families suffer. The popular song here goes, Afghanistan, it hurts my soul. The troops may be out, but the Soviets have just begun examining what's been called here Brezhnev's mistake, and they've begun, too, to try to heal the wounds of war, wounds which will not be healed easily. Jim Laurie, ABC News, Moscow.
Now the Soviets once again. The aftermath of Vietnam in America is not a bad comparison for what has been happening in a country which lost 15,000 of its sons. Jim Laurie is in Moscow.
For some here, today was a day of meditation, of reflection, of emotion. A day to lay flowers, to light candles sheltered against the wind. This is the Soviet monument to the human cost of the war, but so far it is a simple stone in a windswept field on the outskirts of Moscow. And here hundreds of veterans, parents, and children came to pay respects. My son was 20, and he'll stay 20 forever, she says. Who will replace him? He was my only son. We need a bigger, better memorial, he says, one with a full list of the names of our dead. Does anyone think Afghanistan was a good war, this woman asks? Yet, the crowd murmurs, it was a filthy war. It was Moscow's Vietnam. It spawned a fledgling anti-war movement. But its protest songs only allowed in the open after government policy had changed. I heard the grenades blast, the screams of wounded, the song goes. But who's responsible for this cruel and needless war?
The official answer now given is the late President Brezhnev. The Communist Party daily Pravda questioned today Brezhnev's decision to send troops into Afghanistan 9 years ago. The war leaves Moscow with 35,000 wounded to care for, some of them without limbs, and a shortage of rehabilitation centers. And angry mothers of more than 300 POWs, prisoners of the guerrillas in Afghanistan. The defense ministry does nothing, she says. Sergei was captured in 1982. But for 26-year-old Misha Yezhkov today, there were no words. 4 years in Afghanistan had cost him a leg and damaged his speech. He came and walked away, his thoughts kept very much to himself. Jim Laurie, ABC News, Moscow.
Legacy.